Shabbat Shalom, everyone, and a warm welcome to everyone, especially to our virtual members who have taken time to tune in this happy Father's Day weekend. And to all the fathers, hope that you have a great weekend as you join us today. This morning, we want to take a closer look at the parables of Yeshua and to get a deeper understanding of parables. Let us begin, as we should always, with a word of prayer. Abba Father, we thank you for this opportunity to stand in your presence and in the midst of your people. We pray clarity, wisdom, and most of all, understanding. Your word teaches us, and all we get understanding. We thank you for the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, and most of all, your Son, Yeshua, who shed his blood for us. It is in his holy name that we pray. Amen. As I was researching this topic, there were seven questions that came to mind to help guide our discussion today. Exactly what are parables? What is the relation between rabbinic parables and Yeshua's? What's the purpose of parables in the rabbinic writing? And lastly, what parables are not? I will also explore the details of Messiah parables and what they mean about the kingdom, future and present. And lastly, how do we apply parables to our lives? What is parable? And I'm going to give you three kind of definitions. One of the strong concordance says that it's a mishnah, that's a proverb, a parable, and is a part of speech, which we see is translated mashal. The word parable is in the Greek parables or parabolo, which signifies placing besides or together. A comparison, a parable is therefore literally a placing beside, a comparison, a similitude, and a description of one subject by another. It's a noun, a short story that uses familiar events to illustrate a religious or ethic point related adjective parabolic. And any of the stories of this kind told by Jesus or Yeshua. So, we will also draw a reference from a book entitled Story with the Tent it's called A Story with the Tent, A Comprehensive Guide to Parables of Yeshua or Jesus by Klein Snodgrass. And in his introduction, he stated Jesus' parables are among the best known and the most influential stories in the world. Even if people know nothing of Yeshua, they either know about his stories or how encounters that impact expression like the prodigal or good Samaritan. The importance of parables of Yeshua can hardly be overestimated. At no point are the vitality, the reverence, and the usefulness of the teaching of Yeshua as clear as in his parables. Yeshua was the master creator of stories And nothing is so attractive or as compelling as a good story. You wouldn't hear children say, "Tell us a good fact." They want a story. Story entertains, informs, involves motives, authenticates, and mirror existence. Stories are one of the few places that allow us to see reality, at least the reality the author creates. The storyteller is in control so that we are focused to see from new angles and so that the message cannot be easily invaded. Hearers become willing accomplices even if the message is hostile. From this other world, we are invited to understand, evaluate, and hopefully redirect our lives. Apart from personal experiences, stories are the quickest way to learning. We learn most easily in the concrete, but because we cannot easily remember hundreds of concrete accounts, our brains store most easily in the abstract. Story pulls us into the narrative world where there are developments, plots, and resolution. Without resolutions, which is often how New Testament scholarship seek to view parables, we feel frustrated and ask, why this story? We expect something interesting and insightful, maybe even unique, but certainly something that merits the time the teller asks us. The teller has an agenda, an intent, and thinks the story is important, or the story would never be told. The intent may be merely to entertain, or much more pointedly, to convey truth, convince, and motivate. However, a parable is not merely a story. Parable, in its broadest sense, referred to the Hispanic analogy. For example, God forgives and receives sinner as a loving father forgives and receives a wayward son. Such analogies, first and foremost, are comparisons or contrasts used to explain or convince. Parables, by their very nature, seek to make rhetorical points. Further, some parables are not stories at all. Jesus used a parable as teaching aid that can be used as analogies or a comparison of something earthly with a heavenly meaning. Why did Messiah Yeshua teach in parables? Yeshua gave the following answers. To you, it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of heaven, but is not given to them. For whoever has, to him will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever doesn't have, from him will be taken away even that which he has. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because seeing they don't see, and hearing they don't hear, neither do they understand. So let us examine the scripture further in this context. Please turn to Matthew chapter 13, verses 10 through 17. I'll be using the ESV version. Then the disciple came and said to him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" And he answered them, "To you it has been given to know the secrets," listen to that word, "secrets of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it has not been given. For to the one who has, more will be given, and he will make an abundance. But for the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away." Let me make sure. This is why I speak to them in parables, because they sin, they do not see, and hear, and they do not hear, nor do they understand. And you will indeed see, but never perceive. Verses 15. "For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I said to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it." So what is Yeshua is saying here in Matthew's? "In them the prophecy of Yeshua is fulfilled, which says, by hearing you will hear, and will in no way understand. Seeing you will see, and will in no way perceive. For this people here heart has grown callous. Their eyes are dull of hearing. They have close their eyes, or else perhaps they might perceive with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and should turn again, and I would heal them." But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For most assuredly, I tell you that many prophets and righteous men desire to see the things which you see and don't see them, and to hear things which you hear and don't hear them. Yeshua used the word mystery, a secret. The word mystery, a secret, or hidden truth appears in the Old Testament in the Aramaic section of Daniel, chapter 2, verses 18, 19, 27 through 30, 47, and chapter 4, verses 9. In Aramaic, it is given the translation of mysterion in Greek, which means mystery in the Septuagint. Now, in the New Testament, it is referred to a purpose or plan hidden in the heart of God until the appointed time of divine disclosure of men. And Romans 16, verses 25 and 26, and Ephesians 3 and 3 is your reference. The parabolic method has numerous advantages. Number one, spiritual truths may be converted in everyday terms with which all are familiar. Number two, arresting stories are more easily remembered than abstract spiritual principles enunciating with local colors. Number three, Messiah Yeshua desired to conceal certain truth in parables, thus fulfilling the prophecies of Isaiah 6, 9, and 10. The idea that long inattentive to previous revelation has brought darkness to the eyes of many listeners. To them, the parables of Yeshua create only a greater fog. The question then becomes, why do we need to study parables? They are part of Hashem's word. The parables are born out of life and therefore have a way of touching us in those areas where life is most meaningful and significant. Parables are both mirrors and windows. As mirrors, they reveal our lives and help us to see life and Hashem. I lost it. How did it go back to it? Okay. Now this technology is something else. Okay. How do we study the parables? Study each in its context. So we have to look at what context are we looking at each one of these parables. You have to draw out the main truth of the parable teaching. Then you look for the doctrine illustrated in the parable. I want to shift gears for a moment here and take a look at the origin of parables and how we understand the genre of parables in rabbinic literature. One of the golden texts from learning about the subject is from David Stern's book, Parable in the Midrash. Note, this is not the David Stern who is famous in the Masonic Jewish community, but the professor of a classic Hebrew literature at the University of Pennsylvania. We also will discuss briefly parables from Midrash, the Talmud, and the Mishnah. Now, parables in the Midrash, we are reminded how important it is to be to understand the history of biblical translation, how it went from the Hebrew Aramaic to Greek to Latin and then to English, and all that was lost along the way. A marsha or a parable is used also to designate other forms of rhetorica, such as the fables. A large number of parables are found in post-biblical literature. In the Talmud and the Midrash is the examples that you have found them in. In fact, the Midrash is largely composed of parables. The Hebrew term Midrash, which is plural Midrashim, mean to investigate or study. Also, interpretation, exposition is a homiletic method of biblical exegesis. The term also referred to the whole compilation of homiletic teaching on the Bible. The thematic writers believe that illustrate the deeper meaning of a biblical teaching. It is important for the parable and regarded it as a valuable means of determining the true sense of the law and obtaining correct understanding. In the Talmud, in the Talmud and Midrash, almost every religious idea, moral maxim, or ethical requirement is accomplished by a parable which illustrates it. For instance, parables dealing with kings generally and to Israel in particular, as in Numbers chapter 2, verse 24, the Lord is also poetically likening to a king. You'll see that in Psalm verses 10, 16. Also in Zephaniah chapter 3, 16 through 17, and also in Zechariah 14, verses 16 through 17. Israel is also born of the Lord, and you can see those in Exodus 4, verses 22, and Deuteronomy 14 and 1. Now, the parable of Yeshua, a Hebrew Israelite, was taught in Hebrew or Aramaic, depending on who the audience are. The first five books of the New Testament, however, were written in Greek, yet we should never neglect the critical nature of Yeshua's Jewish heritage and how he was influenced by the first century Judaism. For instance, Yeshua would learn in Torah and in the Oral Torah, the Talmud, the Mishnah, and the Midrash. Given that a parable is a type of Midrash, we now learn why Yeshua came to use parables in his teaching based on his heritage. Many Christians are led to believe that Yeshua invented parables rather than understand that Yeshua taught in the manner that he had been raised, using Mishnah parables to illustrate a teaching. What is the relation between rabbinic parables and Yeshua's? This is a tricky question that needs to be addressed. Rabbinic parables started being written down in the 4th century in the land of Israel. That's quite a long time after Yeshua. Some books and study have unwisely blurred the line between the first and the fourth century. Stearns sums it up simply by saying they were both part of a single genre. This conclusion is based on the work of David Flossner, a scholar whose work, in my opinion, has flaws, but on this specific issue, he might have made his point well, who demonstrated that literary characteristics of rabbinic parables have much in common with parables of the Gospels. People were telling parables already before Yeshua's time, and the genre continued with much similarities of hundreds of years. What parables are not? They are not primarily about doctrine. They may reflect on doctrine themes, but they are primarily about praise or blame. They are not riddles intended to confuse outsiders. Stern argues that in spite of Yeshua saying about to you has been given the secret of kingdom, and in order that they might not see, in Mark 4, chapter 11 and 12, and Stern thinks Yeshua or Mark has been misunderstood. The point is not that the parables were too hard to understand rationally. The point is that outsiders, those who did not remain near to Yeshua and ask questions and learn from him, will not be able to apply them. They will not penetrate the deeper meaning of the parables, which are mysteries, truth of a complex nature involving more than interpretations. To understand correctly, one must be a member of the community. That is based on Stern analogy. Tips for reading parables. When studying Yeshua parable, one should ask, who is Yeshua praising and why? Who is he blaming and why? How does the praise and blame from the parable receive added information from Yeshua's teaching and action with the disciples? In other words, the parables are persuasive pieces of rhetoric that designed to encourage action or belief in certain directions. They are not primarily about information or revealing doctrines. The rabbinic parables may be later, but they provided a wealth of additional content in which we can see the same pattern as Yeshua's parables. They confirm for us the way parables were used in in public speaking to persuade hearers to a new course of action, or to stand firm in good cause of action or belief. We should look for Yeshua parables to function in the same way. This will largely keep us from reading too much later Christian theology into the parables, to imagine that they are about a timeline for the last days or a foretelling of Christendom or anything of that kind. They are persuasive sermons delivered to Jews in Galilee and Judea and Jews' life and faith. Apply Messiah Kingdom Parable. To you have been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside of everything are in parables. Kingdom is not afterlife exactly, and is not people of Israel or people of the church. The modern readers tend to inject meanings into Yeshua's words that are not there, looking in the words of Messiah for a message on how to qualify for a good afterlife. It is naturally for many to see the word kingdom, a code word for going to heaven. This is a problem compounded by the fact that Matthew, the best known gospel for many Bible readers, used the phrase kingdom of heaven instead of kingdom of God. But as many will rightly point out, heaven here stands for God. It's a euphemism like saying in the eyes of heaven. Another temptation is to see kingdom as either the nation of people known as Israel or the visible institution of the church. Christian pastors sometimes ask people to work for the kingdom with the understanding that church is the kingdom. And Judaism, kinship of God, is a more common notion than kingdom. This is because Judaism, like Yeshua, is immersed in the Hebrew Bible. What does Messiah mean when he said to you, the inner circle, those who come to me after my teaching and ask questions, is given the secret of the kingdom. But to everyone outside who sit on the hills and listen from afar, hoping to catch a glimpse of a miracle, they are only parables. Does he mean that the parables are not about the kingdom? Is the idea that the parables are teasers, mere hints, but that somewhere else we should look for Messiah's real teaching? If so, where do we find this teaching? The answer is no. It's not that there are two sets of teaching exactly, although the inner circle does get more explanations and teaching than the hillsides get. But rather, it is the whole package. Those who become part of Messiah's disciple circle, not just the 12, but at least 120 by the time of Act 1, receive the secret. And the secret is not just one thing, it's many things. Those who were in Messiah's disciple circles, the ones who were fortunate enough to be there in Galilee and Judea so long ago, saw that the action of Messiah, they got private explanations and went through the experience of disappointment, terror, disbelief, startling realization, overwhelming joy, and a sense of empowerment through the trial, death, burial, resurrection, and the commissions and the ascension of Yeshua. The secret was being in the disciple circle. It was asking questions. It was watching Messiah do messianic thing. It was seeing the kingdom in action. It was living through the greatest misunderstanding about kingdom. The death and the suffering led to the reign of God. It is possible to be in Messiah's disciple circle now. The requirement is a willingness to consider his words and his actions. The requirement is to do this with others. The requirement is to be a believer. Now let's go back and take a look at the parable of the sower and pull all this together in its full context. Matthew 13, 1 through 23. The same day Yeshua went out of the house and sat beside the sea, and a great crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood on the beach, and he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went to sow. Did that come up? All right. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on the ground, good soil, and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Who has ears, let him hear. Then the disciple came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? And he answered them, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For to the one who has more will be given, and he will have no abundance. But for the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. I believe I can read a little better from this little tiny reading. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecies of Isaiah is fulfilled that saying, you will indeed hear, but not, you will never understand, and you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people here, heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, I understand with their heart, and turn, and I will heal them. But blessed are your eyes for that they see, and your ears for they hear. For truly I said to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and do not see it, and to hear what you hear and do not hear it. Hear then the parables of the sower. When anyone hears the words of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in the heart. This is what was sown along the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endured for a while. And when tribulation or persecutions arise on account of the word, immediately he falls away. Last one. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of rich choke the word, and it proves unfaithful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, and another 60, and another 30. So, here we see this is a parable that a lot of people are familiar with, and this is one of the few that he gives an explanation that the whole explanation of that parable in the same scripture. We see that a sower went out to sow, and he sowed on packed soil, and then he sowed on stony ground and thorn ground and good soil. Now, as he explained it in verses 19, I think exactly, he was talking about the wayside, parables of the waste that was falling on the wayside. And we see in the picture there, when you see these kind of representation of people. You have hardened and triumphant ground. You have stony rock and shallow soil with little moisture. And among the thorns, you see crowded fields, depleted nutrition. And then on the good soil, we see it's all being fertile. And when we talk about the heart of a person, we see that there's no understanding for those that have fallen on the wayside. And we see, as we go down, we see intermediate growth, but no fruit. And secondly, growth become unfaithful. And when, of course, the ones who bear fruit produce the crops on the good soil. And we see that always the enemy is trying to attack, blind. They steal the seed, harassed, scorched by the earth, deceived, choked by the plant, and those who contain limit the crop. So, some questions. When was the last time you tuned out a speaker? Why would a farmer allow precious seed to land on the path or rocks or among thorns? Is he an irresponsible farmer scattering seed at random? How did Yeshua conclude his parable? What did he mean by that? How much of the parable did the people understand? How much did the disciples understand? Why didn't the people or the disciples understand this parable? Did Yeshua design his parable to have trick meanings, hidden meanings, or more than one basic interpretation? What kind of soil do you mostly resemble right now? How long did it take for you to understand the gospel of Messiah? What kind of soil do you, how could you listen more faithfully and attentively to the voice of God? What will most help you to respond to God in the study of the Bible? Let's think about the soil for a moment. If we reread the parable from the perspective of a sower, we get a better understanding of it and why Yeshua himself emphasized the idea of sowing the seed. Yeshua tells us that the farmer scattered seed, which is the word of God, and all types of ground. He then said that the farmer was meticulously planting the seed in the in designing good soil or areas in nice, neat row. Yeshua said he was scattering the seeds everywhere. Now, doesn't that seem wasteful? If I were planting a field, I don't know, some of you may even have a garden that you plant. And I have a garden that I plant. I just didn't throw seeds out like that. If you did, that was wasteful. Now, why would a farmer throw seeds on rocks, thorns, and on the side of the road? You will be careful when you plant. If you was one who had a garden, farm. Actually, this method of planting wasn't so strange back in the biblical time, because the custom of planting was to first scatter the seed and then plow it into the soil. But to help us understand the parable, we should remember what Yeshua said early in Luke 5:31. It is not the heavenly who need a doctor, but the sick. In this statement, Yeshua makes it clear that he came to rescue sinners. His purpose was to bring salvation to everyone. If we keep this in mind, we can see that the parable actually has three meanings. To show that Yeshua came to share the word of God with everyone. We don't serve a stingy God who picks and chooses who is good enough to hear the word. He graciously sows into everyone who is willing to accept the word. Second, to show us how the different soil in our lives can encourage us or stop us from receiving the word of God or the good news, or to encourage us to share the word of God with others. And like Yeshua, we should spread the good news with everyone, not just who are receptive. The soil, we can't ignore the soil types completely, but it's important that we first recognize the message of the generous sower. Yeshua knew that most of the people in this crowd would say, "Wow, great story," and move along with their lives. When he ended the parable with, "Who has ears to hear, let him hear," Yeshua was challenging them to think about the meaning of the parable. That's the message for us today. Thinking about the three different types of soil, not only with respect to with other people, but with respect to yourself as well. It is tempting to say, "Oh, well, he's like the rocky soil," or "he's like the soil with all the thorns and the thorns in it." But Yeshua is suggesting that you think about it with respect to your own lives and the several types of soil that you personally might be experiencing. Some fell along the path. This is in one ear and out the other. Picture a Middle Eastern road hardened by years of travel by men and animals. What happens to the seed when it falls here? It sit on it out in the open for the birds to come and to eat it. Have you ever been like that? Sat in a sermon or Bible study, yawning, nodding off, thinking about something else, not caring, not paying attention? If you don't take care of God's word seriously, you don't even respect the represent the soil at all. You're like a concrete sidewalk. The devil is happy to take God's word away and plant all kinds of new thoughts in your mind. And what then is the end result? I like how it is phrased in the New Testament. The devil take the message from their hearts, preventing them from believing and from being saved. That's not a pretty outcome, is it? Some fell on rocks. These people stayed awake. They were happy to receive the word of God, even understand it to some extent. But when they were tested, they collapsed. They give in to temptation. They have no real roots. They're just not planted deep enough in the soil. They know God's words, but isn't truly become their foundation. It is a superficial faith that springs up when times are good. But when the heat comes, just like the sun on a hot day, the small seedling that's shot up out of the rock will wither and die from the lack of soil and water. We all face with temptation, lust, money, gossip, hateful thoughts, not just a temptation to do wrong things, but to not obey God's commands and not to do the right thing, to ignore a person who could use your help. This is what Yeshua is talking about here, a superficial faith for Bible studies, Saturdays, for when things are going well, but they are too easily given to a temptation and fail when things are going rough. Other seeds failed among the thorns. They heard the word, but did nothing with it. They know the word, but don't truly accept it. They teach it, but don't practice it. They let themselves get overwhelmed by the worries and problems of life. They don't grow in maturity. If we are not earnestly seeking the word of God, it leads to indifference about devotions, about the church, about the Bible, about our relationship with Yeshua. So what happened then? The sources for this satisfaction come from external things like riches and pleasures, good times with the old crowd, getting a buzz, whatever. Even though the seed was planted in good soil, the thorn choked it, just like these things can choke us from depending on God. Again, you are not alone if you ever felt like this is a fault, this or falling into this trap. It's all around us. It's the real world. Who doesn't like a good party? Who doesn't want a piece of eye candy or clinging to them? And who doesn't occasionally get overwhelmed by worries of life? One of the major problems in today's society is depression, feeling of guilt and worthlessness, feeling of hopelessness, always feeling sad or anxious, restlessness, being irritable. Let these things grab you and they can easily overwhelm those seeds of God's word that will never be able to grow to maturity. Still, other seeds fall on good soil, and I'm getting ready to wrap it up, and yield a crop 100 times more than was sown. It will seem like funny math and bad business, but God knew what he was doing when he sent Yeshua to scatter the seeds everywhere. There'll be times in your life when you feel like you firmly planted in the ground in good soil. Use this opportunity to share God's word with others. That's when you become the sower. When Yeshua speaks of a huge harvest, 30, 60, and 100 times what was sown. He's not talking about just the seed he planted. He planted some seeds 2,000 years ago. Those couples of 100 have grown in something like 2 billion believers or more. And Yeshua is saying he wants this to continue. He wants each of you sitting here today to be a sower of seeds. Yes, some will fall on concrete, some on rocky soil, some with the weeds, some will fall on fertile soil. But remember, the fruit of sharing the gospel doesn't just happen on its own. It takes a humble heart and meditation of the word of God to produce a good harvest and to further the kingdom of God. The way you sow your seed will be different. All of you can tell your own story, your own testimonies. Some of you will be in position to lead small groups. Some of you could become teachers and preachers. Some of you could start a small Bible study where you work. Some of you could be on mission trips. There are many opportunities to become a sower if you just keep your eyes open. This is why Yeshua wants you. This is what Yeshua wants you to do. Don't disappoint him. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for an opportunity to share your word in its depth. We pray right now that we hear what your word is saying. And do. We thank you now for the remaining part of this day that we enjoyed you today in the spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. We thank you for all that you do. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen.